Good morning.
Good morning.
Members, friends, newcomers, and people online. Welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury. Please silence your phones if you have not done so. My name is Melody Levy. I became a member of this congregation in 1991. When I came here, I wasn't looking for a religion. I was looking for a community. I was brought up in a non-religious family. My mother was raised as a Catholic, while my father was raised as a Jew. My parents never tried to indoctrinate us into their religion. By the time I was born, they were relatively secular. Every holiday season, the menorah was positioned next to the Christmas tree. And in the spring, there were Easter eggs and seders. I moved from New York City to Connecticut in 1989, and I was stumped. I called my friend Mary, who was a New Englander, albeit from Maine, and I asked her, "How do you do Connecticut?" When we talked again, she said, "Find a Unitarian Universalist congregation." In friendship and in fellowship, being here this many years is still where I choose to be. I have served on numerous committees and boards and have lent a hand where one was needed. The Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury has gathered together for 200 years. We respectfully acknowledge that our physical building is on the traditional land of the Paugusett people. If you are new to this community and joining us online, we invite you to introduce yourself and connect in the chat box. Or tell us where you are connecting from, I should say. At the conclusion of today's service, you will have a chance to participate in a breakout group of individual connection and deeper check-in. I recommend it. If you are new and here in person, consider staying for coffee conversation. I have only two, well, I have three announcements. The November 6th Sunday service will be led by Reverend Daniel O'Connell, who served this congregation from 1996 to 2002. And Music at the Ridge on November 6th will feature Pat Wichter, a Brooklyn-based multi-instrumentalist who spent most of his growing up years in South America and Europe and claims many cultures as influences on both his writing and performing. Tickets can be purchased at Eventbrite or www.musicattheridge.org. Okay, again, Trunk or Treat will begin 20 minutes after this service ends, and even if you haven't RSVP'd, you are welcome. And again, welcome.
Good morning. I am Sally Mandler, today's service coordinator, who will also be presenting. So as you can see, people in this congregation wear multiple hats. Before we begin, as people are settling in, let's take a moment to greet one another, and those of you online, say hello in the chat. I love this part. This part is so much fun.
You know, there's more people here than normal.
Yeah.
Am I wrong? I don't know.
No. This is a great turnout. Thank you all, and now join in as we sing our hymn of welcome, "Just as Long as I Have Breath."
Thank you.
again.
Please join me as we light the chalice. Love is the spirit of this congregation, and justice is its light. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek and speak the truth in love, to help one another, and celebrate life. Now, Sierra Marie will help lead us in the children's affirmation and the story.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Can you all hear me?
Yes.
Yes. Hopefully the online people can hear me.
There it is.
Here we go. Now the online people can hear me. Let's say together the words for the children's affirmation, which are on the screen. We are Unitarian Universalists. We are people with open minds, loving hearts, and helping hands. We care for the earth and each other. It's been a while since we've had a storybook. But Reverend Randy recommended one for today, so I thought I would go ahead and read it. This is The Invisible Web by Patrice Karst. The very best news ever has begun to spread all over the world, one heart at a time. Shout it from the mountaintops. Every single one of us is connected to those we love by invisible strings. That means Giovanna and her daddy are always together, even though he moved to a new home. Omar can feel the tugs of love from his parents, even though he is living far away at school. Mr. Chang still feels Mrs. Chang close by, even though she died such a very long time ago. And you, at this very moment, may feel the string of someone close to you. Might you feel that? A little string, even though they aren't there. You can't see it, but it's real. Our strings reach everyone we know. They travel far and wide to families and friends, classmates and coaches, bus drivers and babysitters, neighbors and pets, to aunts and uncles and grandparents and grandchildren, and countless other people. And all of those people also have hundreds of strings. Soaring high over rocky peaks and across the seven seas, deep into jungles and valleys, and winding through the busiest of cities, all these strings crisscross one another and create a nest that covers the planet, interlacing us together, cradling us forever, the invisible web. Might remind you of our seventh principle. We affirm and promote that inherent, that interconnected web. The web has no borders and wraps every continent. Within it lives butterflies and flowers, starfish and seahorses, lions and ants, rivers and snowstorms, and all human beings. Giovanna, Omar and Mr. Chang, and of course you and me too. Some say it even reaches to our ancestors and those we cherish from the beyond. One tug on a string sends love to every one of us, woven together in this divine tapestry. And that means just one good deed travels across the entire web. Everything is linked. But sometimes folks can forget. When they can't feel this string, they forget about our invisible web. And that's when strings get tangled up. So I'm gonna just summarize this page a little to keep us moving. But we're dealing with people like lonely Louisa, who isn't invited to sit with anyone at school at lunchtime. But the more people who care for the web, the stronger it remains. The web feels like every parent since the beginning of time, holding and protecting each one of us in millions of gentle arms. What could be stronger than all those hands holding us close? So many supportive fingers can always find a way to untangle strings so that love can flow again. But it's up to every one of us to spread the word. Our time is right now. As we tell our families and friends, sisters will remind brothers, who will write to cousins, who will call their great-grandparents. And again, I'm going to skip a little bit. If we remember the web and tug it often, nobody will ever be left out. We will see others more clearly. The people of the world will look into each other's eyes. They will smile at one another. And when one of them cries, they will all want to help. And they do. And here are some of the ways that they are helping here. And Louisa feels warm and bubbly. Remember lonely Louisa sitting alone at lunch? She feels warm and bubbly inside when a few of the kids in class ask her to join them under the banyan tree for lunch. She knows right then that the invisible web is real. After school, Louisa cries with joy as she strokes her cat, who purrs the news to the stars. And the stars whisper the secret to the clouds, who share it with the songbirds, who serenade the world with this exquisite melody of love at the start of each morning and all during the day, until as the invisible web glitters in the magic of the twilight, the owls take over and hoot the news throughout the night. The invisible web is alive. Its time is right now. It breathes as we breathe, pulsating over our earth, the single heartbeat of life and love. And you know what that makes us all? One very big family. So ends the story. I'm going to invite the children to come downstairs with me, and please bring coats if you have them, because as always, we go outside on Sunday mornings.
We'll save this little life. So great. Go ahead. Use it, please. This little light of mine.
I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine. I'm going to let it shine. This little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Now is the time in our service where we share silent and spoken milestones.
Thank you. I invite you into a responsive reading. The words will be up here. There they are. And a little different than perhaps we do at other times, I'm going to do both parts, and I'm going to invite this side to do the plain text and this side the italicized, and you people at home, do whatever you want. In the rising of the sun and in its going down, we remember them. In the blowing of the wind and in the chill of winter, we remember them. In the opening of the buds and in the rebirth of spring, we remember them. In the blueness of the sky and in the warmth of summer, we remember them. In the rustling of leaves and in the beauty of autumn, we remember them. In the beginning of the year and when it ends, we remember them. When we are weary and in need of strength, we remember them. When we are lost and sick at heart, we remember them. When we have joys we yearn to share, we remember them. So long as we live, they too shall live, for they are now part of us as we remember them.
I'm taking a point of personal privilege here, as I did not wait long enough for the chat milestones. Jackie says, it's been a wild ride. The Headless Horseman is scary. She says that as Gail is on his way to Carmel today. It's the last performance of Hearts of the Hollow. So I wonder if he's the Headless Horseman. And another one from the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Danbury. Gina, I'm guessing that's you. My brother-in-law is back in the hospital for some sort of lung infection they cannot seem to treat. Our thoughts are with him. And thank you to Carl for stepping up and playing additional music for us today. It's much appreciated. Now is the time for our congregational offering. If you're with us for the first time, your presence is your gift to us. Members and friends online, please express your generosity by using the link or the QR code that's on the screen. If you prefer, you may send a check to UUCD here at the Ridge. Thank you for doing your part to support and sustain this community we love. Good morning again. I am still Sally Mandler. As UUism traces its roots to Judeo-Christian religions, I've been prompted to describe for you my experiences growing up in a Jewish home with some of the practices I continue to this day. Some people sum up Jewishness as that old line, "They tried to kill us, we survived, let's eat." I'll admit to being more of a gastronomic Jew, you know, lox, bagels, kugel, matzo ball soup, and so forth. But really, I consider myself a Jewish humanist who identifies quite happily with UCD and all there is to offer here. There's another aphorism that says, if you ask two Jews for an opinion, you get three or more responses. So with those parameters, I offer you some of my experiences and practices under the rubric of Judaism, with props. Yizkor is the Hebrew word for remembrance. Specifically, it is the opening word of memorial prayers recited for the dead during synagogue services. Yizkor services are held by Ashkenazi Jews on Yom Kippur, the last day of Passover, as well as on Shemini Atzeret, which is the eighth day of Sukkot, which some of you may have seen a sukkah or dined in one. It's a temporary structure that we built during the harvest, fall harvest festival. Yizkor is also said on the second day of Shavuot, which happens in the spring. Why the second day? I have no idea. Sephardic Jews are those who are of Spanish descent, including those whose origins are Middle Eastern, and they have similar customs of honoring their departed relatives. It's commonly believed by Jews that saying Yizkor, remembering a loved one and giving charity in a loved one's name helps them gain merit from our good deeds. Reciting Yizkor can serve as an important and reflective time for individuals honoring and commemorating loved ones. The English translation of the Yizkor prayer goes like this. May God remember the soul of my departed, insert the name of your relative, followed by their name, who has passed to their eternal rest. I pledge charity in their memory and pray their soul be kept among the immortal souls of Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, Rebecca, Sarah, Rachel, and Leah, and all the righteous people in paradise. Since Judaism is home, not synagogue-based, though, let's talk about what happens when mourners return from the cemetery. Jews are typically buried within 2 days of dying. This likely stems from the fact that preservatives were not available way back when. To this day, many Jews opt out of embalming, and many others opt for cremation as their personal choice, as opposed to what was done in the gas chambers of World War II. Still others opt for green burials, donating their bodies to science, and so forth. Some of you may be aware of the practice of placing stones on the grave of someone whose site you visit, and I always wondered, why do we do that? Unsurprisingly, there are several different explanations about this origin. It could be that grave markers were not a thing way back when, and small stone mounds simply marked graves. The act of placing an additional stone is a way to preserve the grave site so that as time passed, it could be found again. A mitzvah, which is a good deed, is done whenever a person who walks by a grave helps maintain it by replacing or adding rocks. Eventually, someone thought of adding a big rock with the personal information of the deceased on it. Okay, so we've had the funeral. Now what? Well, when mourners and those who've been to the cemetery arrive at the family's home, they pour water over their hands as a symbolic act of purification. Then comes the meal. Remember, gastronomic Jews. This is called the meal of consolation. Since eggs are one of the few substances that become harder when subjected to heat, hard-boiled eggs are often included as a symbol of strength. Kaddish is said by those in attendance at the home. It is an ancient prose poem that praises God for life and anticipates peace on earth. It does not mention death. Kaddish is said throughout the mourning period. The mourner's Kaddish is intended as a statement of faith at a time when we feel most threatened and fragmented. So today might be an appropriate time given what's happening. I have a copy of the text for anyone who might want to read it. Next comes the mourning period. How long is it and so forth? The first 7 day period after death is called Shiva, and it is a time of intense mourning. You may have heard the phrase sitting Shiva. That comes from the practice by Orthodox Jews of literally sitting on the floor throughout the week, the whole time on the floor. During Shiva, Kaddish is said daily at home in the presence of a minyan. A minyan consists of at least 10 people. Formerly, it was 10 men, and Orthodox still stick with the 10 men. And then props, this kind of candle, is lit during the morning period. It's a memorial candle. During Shiva, mourners are encouraged to refrain from work and other routine activities and to remain home so that friends, neighbors, families, and colleagues and others can visit and offer comfort. In my experience, Reform Jews either shorten Shiva or opt out altogether. Then there's Shloshim. That's the first 30 days after burial. Children who've lost a parent continue to mourn for a year and say Kaddish every day for 11 months and one day, after which time the grave marker, if there is one, is unveiled and you have the dedication. You may have heard that Sheryl Sandberg, formerly the COO of Facebook, observed Shloshim when her husband died. In the United States, we tend to remember our dead on their birthday. Martin Luther King, President's Day, which comes between the birthdays of Lincoln and Washington and others. The big exception, of course, is September 11th. Similarly, Jews commemorate our dead on the anniversary of the death, and that's called their Yahrzeit. We light a Yahrzeit candle on the anniversary of the death, and it burns for 24 hours. My father's Yahrzeit was a week ago today, and I lit the candle at home and gave tzedakah in his memory. Normally, one recites Kaddish in synagogue on Yahrzeits, but since, as you all know by now, I'm not a synagogue goer, so that didn't happen. Instead, when my children and I are together, sometimes on Zoom, we read a version of We Remember, which was today's reading, and which we adapted to be pertinent to their dad, my beloved husband, Gene. I printed a copy of what we read if anyone is interested in seeing that. But meanwhile, back at the shul, we're going back to the shul somewhere. Ah! every Shabbat, that's the Sabbath service, Friday night, Saturday morning, Kaddish is said. In Reform, Reconstructionist, Humanist, and other progressive synagogues, everyone stands and says it, the thought being that we all mourn the 6 million and others who perished in the Holocaust. So to wrap up, Yahrzeits don't call forth feelings of sadness, but rather it's a time of reflection, introspection, and self-examination. If you're in the synagogue for a loved one's Yahrzeit, it's customary for you to provide light refreshments and wine, gastronomics, and at the end to say L'chaim to life. To the life of the one who died, and to think about the blessings received because of that life. Thank you. Now Randy has another musical meditation. Thank you, Carl. Well, it had to happen sometime.
But when my father died, the painful truth of how hard it is to say goodbye started to take root. My memories of wakes and funerals aren't like remembering as though it were yesterday, but I do remember some things, like sitting Shiva for my uncle. We weren't asked to stay for all 7 days. Instead, we came and went, bringing food as is customary. I remember my aunt telling me that round foods symbolize the continuity of life. So I told my mother, and she brought a lot of hard-boiled eggs. I remember returning from the cemetery to sit Shiva. It's a quiet place. It's peaceful. It's a time to set aside for grieving and healing and eating. May all of my aunts and uncles' memories be for blessing. After my father died, I was tasked with setting up his funeral. My mother and I went to a few synagogues, but it wasn't the right fit. She agreed to have a celebration of life ministered by my reverend, the Reverend Daniel O'Connell. Unitarian Universalist memorial celebrations of life are family-driven and focus on remembering and celebrating. My mother and sister and I sat with Daniel while he asked a lot of questions. His intent was to honor what it meant for my father to live. Yes, he had known hardship, had known the agony of being poor of purse, and he gave the better part of his life to work and the people he worked with. My mother's family was bigger, which meant that I went to more Catholic funerals than Jewish wakes. I remember the mass and masses were long and my shoes were too tight. I remember my grandmother was dressed to look her best. I thought the morticians really like rouge. She didn't look her most natural, not like the grandmother who watched Lawrence Welk and played bingo with me on Saturday nights. We had my mother's celebration of life here, ministered by Suzanne Spence. There was a harpist playing Irish music. My mother would have loved listening to Danny Boy and Down by the Sally Gardens. Right before she died, she said to me, "I hope God saved that bed in heaven for me." My brother's life was also celebrated here in this sanctuary and ministered by Reverend Shirley Rank. A CD player was set up and played songs by Sarah McLaughlin. The last time I listened to Angel, I was driving cross country to New Mexico with my friend Katie. She pulled the car over for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. The end of my brother's life was endurable simply because the torment he lived with was unbearable. My brother was impacted by mental illness. Death. It's a place where we gather together and know we are all just guests on this planet at this moment in time. They who no longer walk among us as a friend or beside us as a member of our family, or before us as a guide, they whom we have loved and lost live on through us. Though their journeys are over, we remember them.
I grew up Universalist Unitarian. And throughout the many changes in our Universalist and Unitarian traditions, through the time when they consolidated into one movement, we've had many statements about what are the sources of our meaning. Where do we get our wisdom? How do we know what we know? And now we have our 8 sources. And often we hear emphasis from people about, well, there's a Judeo-Christian side, or there's the scientific humanist side, or there's the earth-based spirituality part. But the first source that is mentioned, the first source that's listed, is the direct experience of that transcending mystery that surrounds us. That means the direct experience by me, by you, the experience of what it means to be alive and what death means. 27 years ago, my daughter died at the hands of a drunk driver. And 2 years after that, I wrote this. Death surprised me today, walking through the house like a distant relative, part of the landscape of life now separated in two. With screeching brakes and crushing metal, death entered our lives and has lurked in the corners ever since. Even on sunlit days, but with each passing hand, another minute, I forget a little how permanent a place is reserved for this visitor who never leaves until I'm surprised again by death's face alongside my saddened one in all the family portraits. My own personal experience of that transcending mystery, that reality which is life and is death. I suspect you each have had some direct experience related to the death of someone you loved. But perhaps you kept quiet about it. But if you have, then you're part of the vast majority of the world. And whether you talk about Allah or you talk about Jehovah, whether you read the Upanishads or look to the Christian scripture, whether you chant on the full moon, you probably had some experience after the death of a loved one where they came back to be with you in some form. A vast majority of people report that in dreams or in dimes found on the ground or in words whispered in the head or in some other way, they directly experience those who have lived with them and now have died. For some, it may even take an extended period of afterlife communication, of being in touch with the understanding that whatever has been is never lost to the universe, that the spirit of whoever was is there, and you may be able to reach out if they reach out. One of the ways that it may be possible to honor the ancestors is not to see them as past and gone, but rather to see them present and with us. And so out of my experience, I bring an invitation to each of us to not hide that away, that if we do dream of them or hear them or see signs of them, if something familiar reminds us of someone we love, we honor them, not by keeping silent about it, but by sharing it. And when someone else shares such a thing, to recognize how sacred a gift they are giving us. The gift of that direct experience they have had with those who have gone before. Now, if that is your path, if that's your experience, then may this be a place where you can speak about it, where you can honor it, where others will listen with heart and with care. And if that is not your path and that's not your experience, that's fine too. But to know that among us, there are many who walk that path of remembering through direct experience of those who have gone before. May we always welcome that possibility in our midst. In just a moment, we're going to have a time of honoring those who have gone on out of this life. Some of you have brought pictures. Some of you have brought objects. And you at home may have some too. What I'm going to invite you to do is bring forth one at a time the things you have brought to bring up memory. And to say the name, nothing more. The name is sufficient because it awakens in you everything you need to know. Because every story could be long and full, but bring us their names and then place the photos. The microphone is there for you. And those of you at home, if you want to text names, I will read them. So I will see them in the chat. And let me begin, if I can find it here inside the pulpit. Yes. Erica Brindle Bishop and Elisa Bishop. Please come share our loved ones, our memories in honor.
Linda Hansen. Spencer and Jean Rangelian. Rita Solomon Shinas and Joseph Shinas.
Jean and John Burton.
Sally and Ray Anderson.
I'm older, and I have a number of people I'd like to mention their names. Chet Harvey, Frank Helm, Laura Asher, Ken Kessler, Lynn Lifshin, Pat Goodale, Sylvia Sikowski Asher, Leonard Asher, and Paul Gershon.
Chuck Fulkerson.
Mary Myers, who passed away this summer, my mom, but also all four of her sisters who were so dear.
My brother, Philip Inkeo.
Neil Levy, my brother. Mary Eliza, a very, very dear friend who mentored me in my early adult years. And my mother and my father, Annabelle and Harry Levy, Annabelle O'Sullivan, Harry Levy.
My father, Paul Robert Tischler. My grandparents on my father's side, Mac and Diana Tischler. And my mother's father, Abe Levinson.
I didn't bring my little sister's picture, but Lisa Christina Hill.
I didn't bring pictures either, but Kathleen King, a very, very dear friend of mine, I lost her about 5 years ago. My grandmother, Agapita Oria, my grandmother, Dorothy Jones, and my uncle, Jose Antonio Oria Peon.
My husband, Gene Beasley, and my parents, Florence and Martin Mandler.
My parents, Jane and Bob Harrington, who both died on Thanksgiving Day, 31 years apart, and my very dear first cousin, the Reverend Dr. Mary Harrington.
My son, Christopher Burbank Corey, died when he was 28 years old in a plane crash.
Didn't realize this was going on today, so I didn't bring any pictures. Unfortunately for y'all, I'm an ancestor worshiper, so my people I've personally known, my grandfather, John Graziano, who passed 2 months ago, my grandfather, Donald Fitzgerald, who passed a year ago, my grandmother, Elizabeth Marinelli Graziano, who passed in 2010, my little cousin, Corinne Kozlowski, who passed 2 years ago. And those ancestors that I honor on my shrine specifically, Frank Graziano Sr., his wife, Elizabeth Adonisio Graziano, Ernest Bourbeau, Iola Gannett Bourbeau, Adolphus Gwinnett, who took cannonball shrapnel to the face in the Civil War and then went back to Vermont to father 12 children. James Fitzgerald, his wife, Mary Crotty. James's father, John Fitzgerald, who emigrated from Ireland to Mount Kisco. His wife, and Mary's father and uncle, Thomas Crotty and Daniel Crotty, whom I'm named after.
And from at home, we hear these names, and I may mispronounce them, but you know I'm thinking of them, and we are also here thinking of them. Brigida Erling Brodex, Phyllis Shaner, Bill Shaner, James Conanton, Betty Trapassi, Monica Seidel and her son, Christopher Seidel, Joan and Al Brodex, Elizabeth Picardi, Louis and Mildred Canarosi, Diane DeCanto, Eugene Canarosi, Annabelle and Harry Levy, Neil Levy, Papa Daniel, Baby Kyle Smith, Baby Elise Francis, Wallace and Louise Parkhurst, Jenny DeFabio, Frank Guida, Casey Reifenstuhl, and Chris Reifenstuhl, Vincenzo Coppola, from Truce, my mom and Barbara, Aunt Louise Bossi, my sister and brother-in-law, Marianne Donderer Kegler and Gisbert Kegler, Willie Westenberg, Oma, Alice and Max, Donald, Mary and Jean Miller, Jim Parr.
My mom, Jeannie Warnstaff, my father, Dale Warnstaff, and my Nana, Josephine Pecora, and my dog, Alfie, that I lost a couple of years ago, is the best dog.
my mom, Evelyn Newman, who I lost a year ago, last June.
We hear the names. Some we know, some we don't. But all of them are markers in that giant web that connects us. Each one reminding us of a long and complex story of family and love and meaning. And in saying the names once more, the story doesn't end. The story continues for us here today. In that spirit, we honor our ancestors.
Please join me as we say the words to extinguish our chalice. They will be on the screen. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts and out into the world until we are together again. Comfortable, I invite you to reach out to those around you, hand to hand, connecting into part of that great web we talk about. Our lives are not our own alone. We can make triple nodes and all sorts of connections. And you at home, feel these hands touching yours. For that's what we remember this morning, are the lives that have touched us, the lives that continue to touch us, the ways in which we honor those connections and that web that supports us no matter what. Go in peace, go in love, go in connection. Blessed be, amen, and namaste.